My topic today is a practical approach to design thinking. Now, how many of us have heard of this term design thinking before? Anybody in the room has heard this term design thinking?
All the time.
All the time?
Yes.
I'm very glad to hear that. You're reading and listening to the right things on the internet. But okay, for most of us who haven't heard, I'm actually happy, because then this is going to be a great learning session for all of us. So, you know, of late, design thinking has become a big buzzword. A lot of startups started adopting this methodology of creating products, but it became so powerful that a lot of offline companies also started using it, right? In fact, my team, the product managers, you know, we decided to even adopt this methodology. And we said that, you know, every Friday, we're going to chop all our meetings, and we're going to instead go out and meet our resellers, go to their offices, sit with them, speak to them, understand their businesses, understand their customers, so that we can use that insight and create a better platform, deliver better products. And it's been extremely insightful for us. This tool has worked very well. And that's exactly why I thought, you know, this is the best topic for me to speak on with all of y'all. So, you know, before I get into the session, actually, quick show of hands. How many of us today in this room are in the business of building websites? That's our primary business. Okay, I see 80% hands going up.
What exactly do you mean by business of? I write website content.
Okay, but do you also develop websites? Like, you design them, you have a team of developers. Yeah, so you're in the business of making websites for your clients. Okay, how many of us also do application development, maybe mobile applications, native apps? Oh, good. A lot many of us. Great. How many of us are purely in the business of reselling hosting or providing email solutions and domain names? We don't provide any other web design services or anything. All right, 5% of the room. Okay. And lastly, how many of us are a digital marketing agency? All right, another 10%. So, okay, great. Most of us are either building websites or doing web applications, right? And even if we're digital marketers or even if we're web hosting providers, the way I like to see it, right, is that we are all in the business of building web-based solutions, right? We are providing technology-powered solutions to our customers. But if you think about this a little bit deeper, right, when you talk about a solution, you are inherently talking about a problem. So today, when a client approaches you and says, hey, I need a website done, or I need to automate something in my company, I need you to build an application for me. Some of you, you know, in the morning said that you're in the business of making an ERP or, you know, CRM for some of your clients, right? It's a mandate that's given to you, I need this built, right? And as developers, as designers, as businessmen, it's very easy for us to just get into that mode of actually, you know, just going up and drawing up a framework for our website. What will the landing page look like? What will the color scheme be? You'll do a little bit of research of who the competitors' websites are, how do they look, and, you know, send a few designs to your customer to look at. Or if we're developers, we'll just start thinking about the tech stack, or we'll start coding up a framework. What we have essentially done is just gone into build mode, right? So that's what I want to touch upon today. How many of us have actually gotten really deeper on the problem that the client is facing? Why is it that they're even asking for a website? Maybe that's a straightforward answer. They think internet is booming, I need to be out there. But then their needs don't stop there, right? They probably come back to you for an application development. So why? What is that problem that they're facing in their everyday processes with their teams, with their work? What is it that they are actually trying to tackle, right? There's a great quote by Albert Einstein, which I really like. And he says that if you spend 95% of your time on defining the problem, You need only 5% of the time of coming up with a solution, right? And this is exactly where design thinking comes into the picture. Design thinking, you know, a lot of us might think design thinking is about making a website look pretty, it's about the graphics and artwork and, you know, aesthetics. It is not that at all. So let's drop that notion right now before I go ahead with this presentation. Design thinking is a problem-solving approach that any and all businesses can apply. Right now, I realize this is a very broad statement, and in order to actually explain what design thinking is, I'm going to take help of a case study. There's a very, very famous case study in the world of design thinking, and it's called The Good Kitchen, right? So this was a problem that Denmark as a country faced some time back. In Denmark, the Danish government sponsors meals for their senior citizens. So every day, the government cooks meals and sends it to these senior citizens' houses to make sure that they're well fed and they're nourished. And this population was growing. There was a rapidly increasing aging population in Denmark. And they did a survey to just to see, you know, like, how is this working out? How is this program working out? And very shockingly, they found that 60% of these senior citizens had poor nutrition. And 20% of them were actually clinically malnourished. Now, this was a very baffling situation for the Danish government. They said, how is this possible? We are trying to, you know, cook the best type of food and provide it to these senior citizens. Why are they not eating? You know, how is it that they're still malnourished? So what did the Danish government do? Right, they hired a consultancy called Hatch and Bloom. And the problem, the mandate that they gave this consultancy is fix the menu. They thought that their senior citizens don't like the dishes that they're creating and, you know, sending to their houses. They thought maybe they want to eat something else. So Hatch and Bloom took this problem, and they dug a lot deeper into why this is happening. And this is something we call as journey mapping. What they did is they actually went out there on the field, right? On the one hand, they shadowed delivery boys. They watched how these meals are dispatched from the government kitchens, sent in those delivery vans, how those delivery boys are giving this food to the senior citizens, how do the senior citizens receive it, unpack it, cook it, eat it. And also, on the other hand, they went into the kitchens and they watched these cooks prepare the food. And at the end of this exercise, what they realized was that, number one, and this is something that the government completely missed, right? The senior citizens were very embarrassed to accept government help. Now, in Denmark, it's the social custom that if you need help, you will go to your family first, you'll approach your friends maybe, but getting help from the government is a bit awkward. You know, it's an embarrassing situation for these senior citizens. The second key thing that they realized is that after personal hygiene, the second most important thing to these senior citizens was the food that they ate. They wanted to have control on what they consume. A lot of them even grew their own seasonal vegetables in their backyards and their gardens, and they wanted to use that. They wanted to have seasonal flavoring in their food. But they had no choice or any control over what they were eating on a daily basis. And lastly, they were eating alone. They were very disconnected from society. They were being sent food from somebody. They couldn't put a face to this person. You know, their families were not around. So it was a very isolated and disconnected situation for them. And Hatch and Bloom realized that the less they enjoyed this situation, the smaller their appetites. And this is why they were not eating, that this is why they were not nourished well enough. And on the other hand, they also realized that for the cooks who are creating these meals, they are not very motivated about what they're doing, right? Working in a government kitchen is a very boring job. It's a low status job, it doesn't pay very well, you're making the same meals day in and day out. You know, it's a government run kitchen. So the workers were demotivated and bored, and on the other hand, the senior citizens were not enjoying their situation either. So what did Hatch and Bloom do to actually fix the situation? They said, we need to shift mental models. We need to make people start thinking about this differently. Everybody has a very dreary image of the situation and people are very demotivated, so we need to get rid of that, right? So they said, what if this food delivery service was a restaurant? And they got all the key stakeholders in a room. They got the municipality, they got the senior citizens, they got the cooks, they got the government, and they said, okay, let's, you know, think about this differently. And this really created a very creative rush. The kitchen became a restaurant, and so the cooks started thinking of themselves as chefs. And as we all know, you know, the word chef has a much better status attached to it than a cook. So you feel a lot better if you're called a chef rather than a cook. And the vehicles that were delivering this food were spruced up. You know, they were the waiters in some sense. They were given like a fresh, they were upgraded, they were given a fresh look and feel. And also, more importantly, the government started thinking about these dishes differently. When you go to a restaurant and you read a menu, the food is described in such an enticing way that you feel like ordering it. They use food photography, they use, you know, enticing pictures. It makes you want to eat the food. So that's what they did. Instead of, you know, having boring names of potatoes and sauce, they started describing their food a lot better. And this is the result, right? At the very least, they just changed the packaging. They made it look like a lot fresher. They made it look, you know, more enticing to eat. But more importantly, what they also did is that they created a communication channel between the recipients of this food, that's the senior citizens, and the makers of this food, right? Because both were in their own isolated worlds and they were not really communicating. And this is what really made a big difference. Because on any given day, a senior citizen knew who is preparing their food in the kitchen. They could, you know, use postcards and tell them what they wanted to eat, or just say that, hey, I really liked your food, thank you so much for sending it to me today. And this made the cooks, the chefs rather, feel really good about it. They knew that they're bringing a smile to somebody's face every day. They knew that what they're doing is important to these senior citizens, right? So this is what it came to be known. It came to be known as the Good Kitchen. And in numbers, right, there was a 500% increase in meal orders in the first week alone. And this is an emotional side of it, but the chef here says that if you have professional pride, you'll cook good food. And good food actually comes from the heart. You know, so the government thought that the solution, or rather the problem, was the menu. But Hatch and Bloom used design thinking to really get deep into the problem and understand users, understand their behaviors. And the actual solution that they actually came up with was happier senior citizens with better nutrition, motivated employees that who took pride in the work they did. So this is the power of design thinking. Design thinking is a methodology that is a human-centered approach to solving problems. And because you gain such insights into human behavior, it oftentimes helps you innovate as well. So some of the best companies, right, some of the best apps that we use today use this methodology day in and day out. They're constantly engaging with their users, they're constantly engaging with, the users of their products, and they're uncovering a lot of behavioral insights. So another interesting example is Pepsi. We all know Indra Nooyi, and like I was saying, you know, a lot of offline businesses are now adopting this methodology as well. So Indra Nooyi took it to a different level. She, sometime in mid-2015, switched her leadership methodology to adopt design thinking. And she made it so strict, she told all her senior leadership that you have 6 months to change your leadership styles, your managerial styles and your processes, and start incorporating design thinking. And if they couldn't do it, she actually fired them. So this is how strict she was about percolating design thinking all through her organization. And there's a great podcast that Harvard Business School has done with her on this topic. I'm going to play a little snippet from that podcast for you guys. But what she's essentially describing in that snippet is how they changed the design of a product called Doritos. I'm sure we must have heard it or consumed the chips, Doritos chips. And you know how insights of user behavior actually prompted that change in design.
We are working on design of products for women right now. Okay, in the past, in snacks, we just say, hey, Doritos, we'd put it in a pink Susan G. Komen bag and say, that's for women, okay? That's okay. Women interact with products that are for Susan G. Komen. But, you know, men, when the bag is depleted, you pour the snack into your mouth. You know, typical guy does that. Women don't do that. Women worry a lot about how much stain you have from the product because you know, you can't rub it on a chair, which a lot of guys do. So in China, what they've got is they have a stacked chip that's on a tray. It's in the drawer. Mm-hmm. So when women want to eat it, they open the drawer and they pull the little tray out of the container. And when you eat it, it doesn't give louder crunch because women don't like other people to know they're crunching away. And it's very delicate. Okay, because it's on a tray, when you finish with it, you push it back in and it's done. It's put away very neatly.
So yeah.
Maybe. You're not so discreet as to leave it and waste it.
Not at all. Yeah, you just pour it in your mouth. So no shame about that.
The average woman probably eats it differently.
Exactly what she's saying, right? So women are more conscious about how they eat. They don't like stain. They don't even want to know that they're crunching.
Maybe they're very clandestine.
Yes, they are clandestine.
Yeah.
Right? They're more conscious about how they eat. And that's important, right? Because this product is being consumed by women. So in China, what they did is that they changed the way the product is delivered to women. They didn't put it in a packet, they stacked it on a tray. They reduced the crunch of it, they changed the texture of it, so that when women want to eat it, they just need to pull a little tray out, put one in their mouth, it doesn't crunch, nobody knows that you're eating, you're clandestine, and then you just push it back in, it's neatly done and put away with. Right? So these are the insights that they went out in the market, they got these insights. And they changed not just their packaging and, you know, the way they're selling the product, but, you know, it has a big effect in Pepsi because their machinery is changing all the way back to the supply chain. So it's a huge deal for a company like Pepsi to adopt this methodology, but they swear by it today. Right? So what does this really tell us? As creators of software, as creators of technology, right? In some senses, we together are building the internet. Who are we building this for? We're always building solutions for human beings, right? At the end of the spectrum, it's a person, it's a human being who is interacting with a website. It may not be your client, it's going to be your client's customers. Or maybe it's your client who is using the technology application that has been built, right? And if you notice everything that we do in a day, they are not just functional tasks that we do. They are functional plus emotional tasks that we do, right? So this methodology basically encourages us to understand the users that we're building this technology for, right? And maybe some of you might think that it requires a creative genius to come up with insights and, you know, really understand the psychology of users. But it's not like that. There's a very simple step-by-step process that you can apply. The next time a client probably comes to you with a requirement, you can use this methodology to get a little deeper into their requirements and give them a much more meaningful solution that will also be emotionally delightful. Right? That's not only going to help you stand out from the market, differentiate yourself, but it's also going to make your client a lot happier and increase their stickability with you. Right? So how do we do design thinking? This is the process. It's a really simple five-step process, which starts with empathizing. Empathize with your users. Define their problem clearly. Ideate a large set of solutions that could help them. Right? So they might think that the solution for them is some application, but maybe there's a better way of doing what they're trying to do, or there's a better way of solving their problem, or the application probably looks and functions differently than what they think it should look and function like. Then you go into prototyping, just, you know, sketching up your idea, or, you know, what kind of a solution you're thinking of. And then finally you go into testing. Okay, we're going to dive a little deeper into each of these processes. So empathy is the first step. This is also the center point of design thinking. Design thinking is all about empathizing with your user. Now, how do you do empathizing, right? So like it's mentioned, you don't just understand the current experience of the user. What is their current state? What problem are they facing, maybe with their team or, you know, with their customers? But you also understand what means functional tasks for them and what means emotional tasks for them. And what is meaningful to them at the end of the day. So the best solutions actually come from the best user insights that you get. Right? For example, maybe some of you are building a billing software, for example, for a client. Okay? Typically, the kinds of people who would operate this software, they'll be operational in nature. It could be a clerk sitting in the office trying to call customers and get payments or checks delivered or, you know, bank transfers done. Maybe if you go and spoke to that person in the team of your client, you might realize he's not very tech savvy. So the kind of application you probably need to build is keeping this person in mind. It's not the owner of the company who's going to be using that application. It's his team member who's going to be using it. And is it easy for that team member to understand how to use this application? That's your job to figure. Right? So this is called empathizing. You go a little deeper, understand who's using the solution actually, and build it according to their mental models. Right? So it's very easy. How do you do empathy, right? Number one, just observe. What does this person do today? Does he sit with a register and, you know, manually writes down who he is to collect payments from and who he is to deliver checks to and, you know, who he is to make payments to? Figure out what he's doing right now and figure out how is it even playing on his emotional side. Maybe it's a very frustrating job. People don't pick up his calls, or vendors are shouting at him and saying, hey, make me my payments. There's late. We're not going to give you credit, etc. So maybe it's a frustrating job for him. The other way of doing it is interviewing, and I don't like the word interviewing, I'd rather call it engaging. So maybe if you actually sat down with this person and asked him a few questions about how he does, what problems he faces, you will uncover a lot of insights, right? So observation, engaging with him, and actually experiencing what he does, right? Now, I understand most of us don't have time to sit and experience his day. But at least if you spent, like, you know, half an hour just watching him, what he does, and asking him a few questions, that in itself gives us a lot of insights. Sometimes in this method of interviewing, you realize that people say something, but when they're actually doing the task, they're doing it differently. And that's where your key insights come in when you're designing that application. So Stanford, right, and by the way, this process that I'm talking about is a course at Stanford. There's many ways in which design thinking is taught, but Stanford in some senses pioneered this as a formal teachable method and discipline. And this is their five-step process, right? So to actually test the power of this process that they had put down, they came up with this campaign called Shadow a Student. This was from the goal of improving the education system in the United States. They rolled it out all over the country. About 1,500 to 2,000 teachers decided to participate. What did the teachers have to do? They had to experience a day in the life of the students that they were teaching. So they had to shadow a student from class to class, accompany them in the cafeteria and eat lunch with them, you know, after lunch, what their day looked like. They had to go through the entire experience of living a student's life, and that gave them so many insights that they improved their education systems massively. So that's the first step, empathizing. Now, once you empathize and you gain a lot of insights, you need to define them, synthesize these ideas, and put it down in a very clear problem statement, right? From all the interactions you've had with your client, hopefully their team members, or maybe sometimes their users who are going to be using that product, what have you identified as the intent? What are these people trying to accomplish, right? You formulate that in a clear user-centered statement. And this is very important as a step, because if you frame the wrong problem statement, you're going to land up with the wrong solution. So you need to start in a place that's meaningful to these users, and hence you'll end up in a place that gives them a meaningful solution, right? So definition is step two of this process. Step three is simply just coming up with ideas based on what you feel the problem of the user is, right? The goal of this step is to come up with the maximum number of ideas. Do not think whether it's feasible, it's technically possible. Just if it makes sense, if it's creative, if it's going to help the user, put it down as an idea, right? So this step is not about coming up with the right idea, it's coming up with the maximum number of ideas. Fourth step involves prototyping. Now, why do a lot of design thinkers advocate this step of prototyping? And what does prototyping actually even mean, right? How many of us today, before we start building an application or building a website, designing a website, use wireframes? Anybody in the room uses wireframes? Very few of us. I would really encourage you guys to use this tool, because you can actually test whether your user can understand your application or can understand the website. You know, maybe sometimes copy is not very understandable or the flow is a little cryptic. So before you actually go ahead and build that website, you actually devote development resources in building and designing that website. You can just simply use some wireframes to test how it's, to test whether that idea of yours is actually working out or not. So prototyping helps you to fail fast and fail cheap. You've not put in too many resources behind actually building the real solution. You've just done a little bit of dipstick testing and seen whether it's, you know, whether you are on the right lines or not. So visualizing it and articulating it in visual format to your users is a lot better than describing it to them in words. Even they can understand what you're trying to build a lot better through prototypes, wireframes, mocks, etc. And lastly, after you've prototyped a couple of ideas, maybe three, four, you've gone out there, tested it, seen how it's working out, you freeze on one idea that you feel is working out really well, or maybe it's a combination of one or two ideas which is put into one solution. You create higher fidelity mocks, maybe this is Photoshop and not a wireframing tool, and you go out there and test this final solution as well. Now, testing is another opportunity for you to gain empathy. So watching your user actually interact with this high fidelity prototype will give you even more insights. Are they getting confused at some step? Are they asking questions about how does this work or how does that work? That tells you that maybe that screen needs to be more descriptive, or maybe that button needs to have better words on it. You know, simple things like that which make it clear for users and take out some frustration from their lives. Right? So, I know we've been like talking, you know, this whole day you guys have been sitting, listening to conversations, listening to some great talks. But one of my goals would be that, you know, once you go out of this room and the next client that calls you or the next project that you start working on, you are actually able to put this five-step process into play, right? Maybe not all of it, but just understand how it can work in your day-to-day business and, you know, imbibe this whole thinking of design thinking. So we're going to take a simple design challenge. And it's not going to be difficult or anything. It's going to be a guided step-by-step process that we're going to do together. Before we get into it, I want y'all to pair up. So find a partner, maybe somebody just sitting next to y'all. And what we're going to do is build a solution for each other. Right? If you guys open your folders, there are a few worksheets that have been placed in your folder. Have you found those worksheets? Don't skim through all of them yet. I see few of y'all doing that. Hold your horses. We'll get down to what exactly we're supposed to do. But before you look through these worksheets, do two things, okay? One, between you and your partner, decide who's partner A and partner B. Okay, we're going to do this in turns. So just decide who's A and who's B so that when we actually go through the tasks, you know who's doing it. So the second thing that you guys need to do is think about the design challenge. Okay, what is the design challenge? I want all of y'all to think back to a time when y'all tried to learn something new. It could be that you looked at a YouTube video, you tried to learn some new technology, you tried to learn some new design methodology. It could be anything at all. Okay? Think back to that time. Synthesize how you felt, what made you do that learning exercise. It could be a course, it could be anything. And just think about, you know, what happened, how it happened, what did you feel? Okay, just take a minute, do some individual thinking, and just synthesize your thoughts around it. So through this exercise, your job is to understand the experience of your partner when the last time they tried to learn something. What worked for them, what did not work for them? Why did they even do it? And you need to come up with a solution that makes this better for them. Imagine the next time that they wanted to go and do this. Or let's say a client comes to you and says that I'm trying to do training in my team, but these YouTube videos are not working out. What would you do? How would you help that client actually use, by using this method of design thinking and build a learning solution? So pretend like your partner is your client and go through this process of design thinking with you. Is this making sense? Is everybody clear on what we're supposed to do here? Great, okay. So this is going to be a time-bound exercise. Each step has a time limit to it. We're going to go through each of these five steps in a structured manner. This might feel a little fast. You know, you might feel like I'm interrupting your thoughts or interrupting your conversation. If you feel like that, that's a great thing. Because it means that you're onto something and you're discovering something that's important to your customer, your partner in this case. But trust me, just lean into the process and do this with me. I promise you, you will see some value in this. Okay? So we've already done this. Everybody has synthesized their own thoughts on what they did the last time they tried to learn something. Now, the first step is partner A interviews partner B, asks them questions like, what did they do? What is the topic that they were trying to learn? Where did they go to learn it? It could be reading a book, it could be anything. Just get the basic information from your partner. Okay? You're gonna have 3 minutes to do this. Just talk to your partner B. Alright? And put down your thoughts in the section on your worksheet. Your time started. Okay? I see that I'm interrupting a lot of you guys, so I'm taking this as a good sign that y'all are actually having a good conversation with your partner, hopefully around their learning experience. The next thing is partner B is now going to interview partner A. Right? So partner B is to build a solution for partner A, and he's going to do the same thing. Okay? So time starts now. Okay, so I'm hoping by now y'all have the basics around what your partner was trying to do. Maybe you have some idea of some problem that he faced. The next step, I want you guys to focus on the second part of your worksheets, right? The section called Dig Deeper, Ask Why. So if your partner told you that he tried to do X, I want you to ask him, why did he think of doing that? Okay, so just dig deeper into what made him, what motivated him, what his intent was. Okay, so again, partner A, dig deeper into partner B's motivations and behaviors, and you have another 3 minutes to do this. Time up, switch partners. Now partner B repeats this process and digs deeper with partner A. You get another 3 minutes, start now. Okay, so it's time for step three now. Turn your sheet over and you will see step three. Okay, everything that your partner has told you, just take 2 minutes to think about what could be a solution for him. Okay, just synthesize your findings. You can capture needs and insights in the two columns, right? So each person do this individually now. All right, you have 2 minutes to just put down your thoughts around what solution you're thinking about. Are you guys following? Okay, everybody has put down their thoughts, synthesized their learnings, yeah? Okay, so now we're going to move to the second part of that sheet. Now, this is extremely important for you to fill out well. When you're trying, so the format is prescribed, who is your user, what does he need, and why does he need it, right? If you can be descriptive about your partner and not just use a name, you get brownie points. That just means that you've actually understood who he is as a person. Maybe he's a very motivated learner and he's constantly trying to learn stuff. Put that down as a description, okay? So you get 1 minute to fill out this section, okay? Start now. Okay, time up. We're moving to the next step. Now the third step is the step of ideation. So if you turn your pages, you will find a section where you're required to take 5 minutes and just put down the maximum number of ideas you can come up with to build or to solve your partner's problem. Okay, so take 5 minutes. Don't think about whether this idea is possible. You can build it, not build it. Forget about all of that. Okay, it's feasibility is not the point here. The number and the quantity of ideas is what matters. Okay, so you have 5 minutes. Get started. Okay, last 1 second and time's up. Okay, so how many of us were able to come up with 3 ideas? Most of us? Awesome, awesome. 5 ideas? Put your hands higher, I can't even see. Okay, 20% of the room. 7 ideas? Wow. 10 ideas? 9, 10 here. I saw your sheet. That's great. There's one person who's come up with 10. Anyone more than 10? Okay, great. 10 is still a very good number. So let's move on. Now, what I want A to do is take feedback on the ideas from B. So just verbally describe the ideas you thought of and see what resonates with B, right? You have 2 minutes, quickly describe your ideas and get feedback from B. Okay, time up. Partner A, you had your 2 minutes to bounce your ideas of partner B. Now partner B needs to get feedback from partner A. So switch whatever ideas partner B came up for partner A, bounce them off your partner. Okay, 2 more minutes. Time up. Okay, so by now, do you have some idea of what your partner has liked about your ideas, what's worked for him, what's not worked for him? Yeah, I see some of you guys have put flowcharts and really gotten into the process of what your partner did, which is absolutely great. So we're going to move to the next step now. You have some idea of what your partner likes, doesn't like, what's working, what's not working. What you need to do is take one solution, or it could be a combination of two of your ideas that, you know, can make one solution for your partner. Focus on that one solution and prototype it. So if you were to build an application that helped him do this, what would the flow be? What would the screens look like? What will the functions be? How can he actually go about doing it? It could be anything that you thought worked for your partner. Making sense? Yes? Okay, so you have 5 minutes. Sketch, do flowcharts, don't put down words. Words are very, very limiting. So just think and design something that really works for your partner. Okay, so now this is the last step of the process. I've seen a lot of your worksheets, I've seen screens, I've seen call to actions, I've seen clouds and drawings, and it's looking great, especially people at the back. Some of you have even solved each other's problems already, which is also awesome. But spend some time on this last step and use the format on the next sheet to just put down the summary of everything that you did, right? What worked, what didn't work, what questions did your partner come up with, maybe he didn't understand a few things in your prototype, and finally, what new ideas did come up for you in this process. Okay, so do this one partner at a time. We're going to start with A, filling the sheet out for B. All right, take 4 minutes and your time starts now. Is anyone left to do this? Okay, I'm taking that you're done. Okay, this is the last 4 minutes. Switch partners, B does this. In case you've already done it for each other, just use this time to, you know, put down the final findings and solution that you have. Okay, we give this 4 more minutes and we wrap up. This exercise, I know a lot of you guys have, you know, actually followed this process step by step by step, put down sketches, flowcharts, tons of points. Does anybody want to share a solution they came up with which their partner loved and really worked for their partner?
My partner, when I interviewed, I came to know that he tried to learn PHP. That was 1 year back. And to offer solution to his customer.
Okay.
And he also, in this process, he learned OpenCart.
Okay.
And the difficulty was, actually, a few steps he can't even get a solution for even 1 week, 10 days. There was no guidance for him to learn that OpenCart and PHP. Okay. So it took around 6 months to learn. And now, that is, after the learning, experience for him was, he got good understanding, and he was able to master PHP and OpenCart. It was a good experience. And digging deeper, he became the master. most of his PhP.
But what you said, he said he didn't get enough guidance and it took him 6 months to learn this?
No, the difficulty.
Is that a problem?
Yeah, it was the difficulty. Okay. The first stage, no, when entering.
Right.
What difficulty he was facing is there was no proper guidance. So it took a lot of time to go to the next step.
Got it. You can just summarize the final solution that you came up with and what really worked for your partner.
Actually, now he is a master of the PHP. But the solution what I am offering is, he can build his own new team. Mm. He can coach his team. Mm. And the second thing, for himself, he can upgrade his skills using the forums related to the PHP and Facebook friends, what he has in this master of the subjects.
Got it.
So along with the team and his own skills, no, he can deliver better solution to the customer, better product to the customer, and also offer new solutions to the customer. So the result will be more profit in this business.
Got it. So great stuff. Thank you so much for sharing. It's been good learning experience for you guys. You'll have newer ideas, a lot of knowledge and stats that we shared in the early part of the day, and maybe a little bit more of design thinking that you can actually apply to your business.